मैं ऑडिबल?
यस सर।
So we'll continue our discussion on sampling theorem, and after that we'll go to discrete time Fourier transform. So you see, so this sampling theorem we have discussed with respect to ideal sampling, and we have given the motivation for that. No, so we said that we have a continuous signal, then output is simply convolution between input and its impulse response. But so okay, in general, the signals, input signals, are continuous in time domain, as well as the system impulse response are also continuous. But we can go for discrete time signals, and then we can use discrete system. That is the purpose. So discrete time system will have impulse response of h of n, and discrete sequence is x n. Then the y n is actually convolution between these two sequences. Now this x n, basically it is a sampled version of your continuous input signal x of t. Okay, and here we are not showing the t as sampling rate. We are working with only the samples, but the t s is already given. So for one application, t s should be provided. Otherwise, it is not complete. So you see, we have discussed this one, that I, and this xt is a signal. We are taking regular samples, okay, at t equals to nts, n is integer, and ts is sampling time interval. Okay, so these are the samples, red one you see on the right hand side. So those are x of nts. So in short, we write x of n, we remove the ts. We will work with only the samples, but actually ts is associated with n. Okay, then we have discussed the Nyquist sampling theorem. We have said that if xt is a band limited signal, okay, means its bandwidth is finite, so its maximum frequency content in the signal is capital W. Okay, so spectrum could like may like look like that one. So I told you that this shape of this spectrum, it depends on the signal x of t, not necessarily that it should be a triangular alias. Okay, and you understand that triangular shape you will get only for one sinc square. Okay, because sinc function will give you rectangular shape in spectrum, and again, so if you take convolution between two rectangular pulses with same width, then only you will get a triangular pulse. That means sinc square will give you triangular. So that you can you should try to understand. Okay, so this is the suppose one shape for this band limited signal. Now what you are doing, we are sampling this signal x of t with ideal impulse train, and because of this, what is happening, the spectrum of the sample signal, the x of st is the sample signal, and its spectrum we have computed, and that we have shown that it is a periodic. So if this is the spectrum for x of j omega, then this one is the spectrum, this is your spectrum for xs of j omega. Okay, and you see it is a periodic, and with respect to this omega, no, so and periodicity is omega s, means capital x of j omega plus k omega s is again, it is x of j omega. It's periodic. Okay, so at zero, whatever it is safe, at omega s it is same safe like that. Now, so it is repeated, fine. And if omega is sufficiently large, at least if it is more than 2 times of the capital W, and where capital W is the bandwidth of the signal, then you will see that you will find certain gap between these two ends. No? Means they are separated. These two spectrums are separated. They are not overlapping each other. So if they are not overlapping, then using a low pass filter, suitable cutoff frequency you can choose, not necessarily again WS by 2, just you should include this whole spectrum. That is fine. So we need to select this the frequency spectrum around the origin only. Okay, that we can do using a low pass filter. And you know that low pass filter we have already discussed. So low pass filter in frequency domain is a rectangular pulse, but in time domain it is a sine function. Okay, so again we have discussed that if omega is less than 2W, then you will find that the signals are, so in the spectrum domain the shapes are overlapping each other, then you will get some distortion. So from this one, if you try to recover the signal using a low pass filter, you won't get the same result, same shape, because it is now distorted. So this is the now new shape. So earlier you see it was like this. This was the shape, but now you have got this shape. So it is a little bit different distortion that we can't avoid. Okay, if omega s is less than 2W. So this a omega s equals to 2W is called Nyquist sampling rate. Fine. Then we have discussed that in time domain, what is the meaning of this one? In low pass filter, the h of t is sine function. So you see x t, when it is multiplied by pt is your impulse train, then you are getting one sampled version of xt, that we will call it xst. Then if this xst is passing through a low pass filter, you will get exactly x of t, provided that xt is band limited and it is this sampling rate is sufficiently high, omega s should be more than 2B or 2W. Then you see what I have shown, that this output yt is basically it is the sine function located as at nts, okay, and with amplitude x of nts. This is, you see, this is the samples of xt at nts. So that is the weightage associated with this sine function. Then if you add all those weightage sine function, you will get back the signal xt that we are looking for. So we expect that this will give you exactly xt. Okay, and this is possible. Again and again I'm saying this condition is most important. Omega a should be or equals to more than 2W. Okay, and if it is less, you will see, because what will happen if it is less, TS is large. If omega S is less, TS is large, then what may happen? Suppose if this is the signal, okay. Now if you take sample at here, and if you take another sample at here, and so this is your time. So even though if you use low pass filter, you can't interpolate, no? So from these two sample, you can't guess that you will have this kind of zigzag. This undulation is there. So you can have a smooth curve. That you can predict. So we lose this information clearly if the samples are too far away. But if samples are close enough, so if this is 0, it is TS, it is 2TS like that. But instead of that, so if the same shape, then I want to replicate it. Okay, now if I take a sampling rate like this, then you see now we can have good interpolation that you can do. No? So this thing easily you can do. This one it is fine. This is fine. Okay, that is okay. So we can get back the original signal XT. If TS is sufficiently small and omega S is very large compared to at least 2W. Otherwise, you will get aliasing. So this is with respect to ideal, means impulse train. Now, one difficulty with this impulse train is that you have to provide huge power because impulse means infinite magnitude. So power is infinite, okay? And that is obviously impractical. You cannot provide an infinite power for sampling. Okay, so what else we can do? Okay, now for practical sampling, the same signal XT. So again, we can go for one multiplication, one periodic signal. Not only the impulse train, we can go for one PT, which is a rectangular pulse train. Instead of impulse pulse train, okay? Means what? If PT is like this, this kind of, I want okay. So this is our 0, then it is TS, then it is 2TS, like that. So period time period is again TS is the time period. But width of the signal is suppose very small, okay? That could be tau, the width is tau suppose. This width is very small compared to, so tau should be very, very small compared to TS, right? So if I multiply these two signal, then also we'll get certain kind of sampling because you try to understand this one, what you will get. So again, I'll draw one signal here. So this is your signal X of T. Right? So when this is multiplied, this is your P of T with respect to T. And this is your X of T signal. And now we need to multiply and we'll get it x s of t. So x s t, x of s t is the product of x t and this periodic signal p t. Okay, so what you'll get? So when suppose this height is 1, okay, height I'm considering 1. So obviously, so when this is multiplied, you will get the same height of this signal here and this one But here it is the same cell. No? Because within this 0 to tau, this is the p of t is 1, and that 1 is multiplied with xt, you will get the same shape xt. So this curve, see here you will get a curve. Okay. Again, as ts, you will get this one. Similarly, 2 ts, 3 ts, is it right? So these are the sampled signal like this. So this is your TS. This is your 2 TS, 3 TS, this end. Okay. So what is the idea? So can you guess what would be the spectrum of XST? Anybody? We have discussed earlier the spectrum of XST, which is for ideal impulse train signal. So can you guess? Anybody can respond, please? The PT is a periodic signal. If PT is periodic signal, what you can do? Always you can write a Fourier expansion from Cn times and it will put J n omega naught, and in this case it is omega s and t, and n is minus infinity to infinity. So Cn you can find out what this rectangular pulse. Okay, I think we have discussed this one, how to find Cn, all those things, so I'm not going to discuss. This obviously, this function Cn, you will get from sinc function. That probably you understand. The Cn shape. It's like this. So you will see the Cn values are like this. Roughly, I am drawing. These are the Cn values. Is it correct? Are you getting me?
Yes.
Am I audible? Okay. So, in impulse train, you will see that Cn was constant, 1 upon Ts. Okay. But in this case, it is not constant. It is fine. It is certain amplitude, and that amplitude we can calculate. Basically, the envelope is a sinc function. So what you can guess? You can guess that again, the signal will be periodic. No? It will, signal means this a Fourier transform of XT. Because of this one, because here PT is periodic, and we can find the Fourier transform of this PT, and then you will get Cn, it is 2 pi. So what is your Fourier transform of PT? So this is simple. So 2 pi is, okay, I can take outside. This is Cn, and it is delta n minus, sorry, omega minus n omega s, right? And n equal to minus infinity to infinity. Is it correct? And you see this XST, that is your product between these two. Product means XT and PT. This is the product only, not a convolution. Be careful. So Fourier transform of XST So you can use multiplication property. Probably 1 upon 2 pi. And this is your capital X of j omega. And you should take convolution with this Fourier transform of Pt. And you see Fourier transform of Pt is having impulse train, impulses. So whenever you will take convolution, it is shifted. So it will become again periodic. So only changes is that Cn, this time Cn is not constant. Cn is having this magnitude of Cn is will vary, and its envelope will show one sinc function. So what we can guess, this capital Xs of j omega versus omega. So here, so okay, first I will draw in big way. I will draw this. This is your sinc function. Right? You continue. So suppose this is your 0, this is your omega s, this is your 2 omega s. Okay, I'll take a little bit here. This is omega s. This is suppose 2 omega s, this was 3 omega s, this is 4 omega s, like that. Okay, so here you will have the spectrum of x of s, so that I can draw. So this is your capital W, it is minus W. Bandwidth. Again, here, this is the height. Okay, and here, this is the height. Here, this is the height. Here, again, this is inverted. Okay, we can draw in that way, make the sign like that. Is it clear? Is it fine to all of you? What I am saying? The spectrum of X is X of S j omega. That is, it looks like a periodic, but not exactly periodic. To repeat itself, but with some scaling factor with Cn, and Cn, it is varying with just like a sinc function, but still we can recover, the original signal from the spectrum if this, they are not overlapped, no? If omega s, again, is more than 2b or 2 to capital W equal to, then we can use one low pass filter like this. So if I use this low pass filter, we can select only this shape, okay, and that will give you original message signal. And only multiplication is that C0. Okay, C0 is one constant. Quantity value. Obviously, C0 is non-zero because we have used a rectangular pulse. So it should have certain DC component. Okay, so you will get C0 times X of T, or some TS is also associated. It's fine. But idea is that using low pass filter, you can reconstruct original signal X of T. It's possible from this sampling. But here, you see one problem again. Here one advantage is that we can give finite amplitude, so that is amplitude is one, and certain width. So power of this signal is not infinite. Okay, but you see, its top position is not flat. Okay, it is this shape. The shape of the original signal that is included here, and that may create one certain problems. No, so while you transmit this signal after sampling, so 1 minute. So this signal, its top is not flat, but if it was flat, it is much, much, much more better. Then you know that one rectangular, so one, it is sampled at certain point, and one simple rectangular pulse is used for sampling. Have you got my point? Here, this rectangular pulse is multiplied. That's how its top position is not flat. I want this one. So this is this one, and now if I get like this, so it will take sample here, and then that sample value will remain same. At this point, it will take the sample, and it will remain same. Okay, so it will take this remain same. And this method is called flat top sampling. Okay. Have you got the difference between these two? One is flat top sampling and a sampling with regular pulse, rectangular pulse train. Is it clear? Please respond, otherwise I can go ahead. Anybody? Is it clear to you, or just I am discussing, you are not getting anything?
Yes, sir.
So please respond quickly, otherwise I can't, because this is online courses. You are not showing your videos, and I am not showing my video. So only that we can understand whether you are getting everything or not. So if you have some confusion, please let me know. I'll discuss again and again, because these are the important concept you should understand. Okay, this flat top sampling is little bit different with respect to the previous one. Earlier, just we multiplied these two. Now, how to get this flat top sampling? What is the concept? The flat top sampling. You see, if I consider a signal like this, okay, so I'll take samples at regular interval. So this is the sampling time, okay. Intentionally, I'll take larger sampling time. So that figure is clear to you. Okay, this is your T. So here you will get an impulse. If I multiply that signal, so you see. So first of all, you will get the impulse here. So why? If this is signal XT, and if you multiply with this one with your PT, and where PT is like this, one impulse train. Zero TS, two TS, three TS like that. It's an impulse signal, it's a PT. The summation of del T minus NTS, right? And N is minus infinity plus. So this side also there. Remember. So just you're multiplying. This is your actual signal XT. Now this one I am writing XS prime T. Okay. At this moment. Now what I want? I want a rectangular shape here. Okay. So how to get a rectangular shape with the same amplitude? So you see x of nts, xst is basically the xt multiplied with pt. And pt So you see it's a XT and PT is summation of del signal del minus NTS. So now I can multiply this one inside that we have done earlier. So you will get X of NTS because it is located at TS only. Then it is del of T minus NTS. So still now we are getting impulse with this voltage. And you see this is the sample of XT at n equal to NTS, ideal value. But this width is almost zero. It's with zero only, okay? And there you find infinite forward. So what I want that same height of X of NTS, but this should be a width, okay? So I want like this, that same height, this one, and it should have a width like this. This one, it should be like this. Okay, so I'm showing a little bit bigger width, but in general, this width is very small. So this is tau. This is TS plus tau. So this width is tau. Is it correct? So how can we get this one? Any idea? So what kind of system you can include here so that you will get this kind of sample signal, XST? Anybody have any clue?
Is it integrator?
Integrator, but integrator will compute the integration after infinity, no? So if you apply impulse in this impulse at origin, no, at the input side, and if you use an integrator, what you will get? You will get a stable signal continuously, but the width should be only up to tau. So you are very close, very, very close. No? I need a width of tau only. So what should be their impulse response of this signal, of this system? So if this is your impulse, del T at the input. So if I want that output should be like this, that is your impulse response. That's simple. Because the input is impulse, the response, whatever you will get, That is the impulse response. So if I have an impulse like this, and for that I should get a rectangular up with that one, that implies that I need to get this kind of impulse response. So this impulse response of this system should be like this. This is one, t. This is your h of t. Then we'll get this kind of flat top sampling. Is it clear? Is it convincing?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now, can you tell me that what is the spectrum of this XST? So already we have computed the spectrum at this end, and we have seen that it is a periodic in nature. Actually, ideally periodic. Amplitudes are also constant, right? And that periodic signal. So you understand that the XST is now XS prime t that we need to take convolution with, this convolution with h of t. So if you take Fourier transform on both sides using convolution property, the capital X of j omega is capital XS prime of j omega multiplied by h of j omega, right? And this is a periodic. This is periodic in nature. And the spectrum of h of j omega. So you see, if this is your h of t, its Fourier transform will be again a sine function, magnitude part, okay? So only there is certain shift delay, and due to this delay, you will get a phase delay, but magnitude spectrum will remain same. So I am talking about magnitude spectrum. So this time delay is corresponding to phase delay. Fine. So here, if you see that this is multiplied, no? Now this XS prime j omega should be multiplied with h of j omega. Now can you draw these things? Then you will be able to understand. I'll draw in bigger size. So this is your and this end, this I'm saying that this is your h of j omega. Remember, the mod only I am considering. The phase shift I am not taking into consideration. Actually, it is the h of j omega times e to the power minus j omega tau s by 2. Right? So that part I am excluding for simplicity. And you see your x prime s j omega, it's a periodic in nature. Okay. So this is 0 and this is your t, sorry. This is your omega s, this is your 2 omega s, 3 omega s, like that. This is omega. This is again omega. Okay. Now we need to multiply these two together. Okay. We have to multiply these two, remember. Okay. Then what you will get? You multiply these two. So you see this spectrum is multiplied by this function. So if I draw this one. No? So earlier, suppose we used to get this one. if it is flat, but this is not flat, this is some curvature. So you may get some kind of distortion here. Is it a little bit convincing? Because point by point multiplication, amplitude will not remain same. Suppose if it is 1, so this 1 is multiplied with this 1, okay, it will remain same. But this is now decreasing. So that coefficient, that values are multiplied continuously. So its value will reduce a little bit more toward this side. So little bit distortion you will get if there's a curvature here. But if it's totally flat, then you won't get any distortion here. Similarly here. So its amplitude is reduced, no? Would be like this. So here, it will be like this. So I need to select, I need to use a low pass filter. So this low pass filter is sufficient to select this only low frequency zone, but the output, this is your original message, but this time you may get this kind of curve. Okay. So some sort of distortion you may get using this flat top sampling. Now how we can reduce the distortion? What is the condition? Can you tell me? Suppose I wish to reduce this distortion. So what should be that width for tau s? This one. Any idea? With the tau a small value, you will get low distortion, or with the larger value, you will get low distortion. Can I respond, please? I wish to reduce the distortion. So what's the choice with respect to this tau s? Tau s should be chosen as a high value or low value. Can you guess? Am I audible?
Yes,
please respond. This is very, very simple idea. I don't know why you are not getting this thing. If tau s is small, very small, so what should be the envelope of the CN? CN will be more flat. It's again still it is sync function. No? So this envelope is important. If I am considered one like this, this is my rectangular pulse, TS. Okay, and for that, in time, the sync function, so this is your h of t, and h of j omega, it's magnitude only, I'm guessing, okay? So you will get this kind of sync function. Now, if I reduce like this, this is your h of t. Now, what is the Fourier transform? Fourier transform, okay. So, h of j omega is magnitude. What you can expect? Tau s is small. So, in time domain, it is compressed. In frequency domain, it is expansion. And you see, if it is becoming very small, almost like this, and that time you will get almost flat. Okay, somewhere there it is reducing. So within a narrow band, it will remain flat, then distortion will be reduced. But that is the idea. So when signal is present, it is this one. This is the capital W, no? So within this capital W, if it is flat, then it is done. I mean, distortion is less. And if you find certain curvature, then you will get more distortion. So to reduce distortion, we need to reduce the TS. So if tau S is small, so distortion is less. And you will get a good sampling, no? Because this is your signal, and you are taking samples like this. Very, very narrow sample, but flat top. Very narrow. Is it okay? Otherwise, you have to design, if you choose larger value of TS, then because of this, you are having some distortion. And to avoid this distortion, we have to design proper filter. The filter characteristics may not be ideal one. So to get distortion less, so we have to choose certain output filter. So you see here, so from this XST, I need to use a low pass filter, that is fine. But if the tau is very small, but if tau is large, then you'll see this is not exactly low pass, some kind of high pass thing will be coming, okay? So that I'm not going to discuss. So I think this knowledge is sufficient for sampling. Any question from the sampling? Do you have any question from the sampling theorem or sampling process? Please try to understand, this area is a little bit mathematical and conceptual. Okay. If you don't have any question, then we can move to the next topic. Okay. We'll go for that. So next one is discrete time Fourier transform. So in short, it's called DT right. So what the concept? So already we have discussed continuous time Fourier transform. Now we want to extend the idea to discrete time, and that's how we have discussed the sampling process, because from continuous signal we have to get the discrete time signal Xn, and for this Xn we have to find out its Fourier transform. Okay, so Xn is discrete sequence. Okay, the sequence So you know that it is NTS is already multiplied x of NTS, that is your x of n. So this signal is a xn. Now we want to find the Fourier transform of this one. So what is this? And you know that we have got the idea about the Fourier transform for the periodic signal with the help of Fourier series concept. First, we have made a periodic signal out of this aperiodic signal, taking certain period, two large period capital T, and then that capital T, when it is going becoming infinity, ideally that signal is becoming aperiodic. That was the idea. Okay, so same thing we can do for this sequence as well. Fine. So what I'm saying that, suppose if I have a sequence of this one, so this is a sequence, this is your n, this is your x of n, and for simplicity I am taking that left side is all zeros. And beyond certain samples, suppose this sample is n equal to n1. Up to n1, it is non-zero values. And beyond that, there are all zeros. So this is your actual sequence, aperiodic sequence. Now, if I can make one periodic sequence from this one, and we'll think that this signal it will repeat after certain time, certain samples. So here, this is your n equal to capital N, again it will repeat. Okay. Again, at n equals to 2n, to repeat. And that. Similarly, this side. So here, you can see there's a repetition. So this is your zero. It will repeat at here, but it is time limited signal. So n equal to n1. Beyond that, so from n1 only it is becoming zero. Okay. So zero to n1 minus one, it is some non-zero values. Right. So what you can do? This is some periodic signal we can find, so I can write xp of n. It's a little bit different from this xn because this is the periodic version of this xn. And for this periodic signal xpn, we can use Fourier series. So can I use Fourier series? Because for any periodic signal, we can expand it using Fourier series expansion, whether it is a continuous or discrete. So we have not discussed the discrete one right now, so it is very similar thing. So this xpn, what we can write is in expansion, you will see again we can write ck and e to the power j, then k omega naught. And it was earlier about k omega naught t. So you see in continuous domain, signal xt is cn e to the power j n omega naught t. okay, omega naught is the time frequency, angular frequency, fundamental angular frequency. Okay, so here we are considering k, so k equals to minus infinity to plus infinity. Same thing I can use also n, but as I have considered n is a sequence, to avoid this thing I have considered here k, right? So c sub k, and if you put j k, now omega naught, what is the frequency? And you see the analog frequency, angular frequency, 2 pi upon t naught, and for this discrete, what we'll get, it is 2 pi upon how many sample? After capital N sample, it will be fit. So it is 2 pi upon capital N. This is your frequency. So that I can put here, k into 2 pi upon capital N. This is equivalent to omega naught in continuous domain. And then the sampling index N. Is it clear? This form, XPT could be expressed in this form. The CK times if you put J, K, 2 pi upon N, capital N times small n. Okay. And from here, we can calculate CN, its coefficient, with a series coefficient CN. Again, same thing we can do. So 1 upon t, so you know that how to calculate Cn, okay, I'll get Ck, okay. So Cn for continuous, it's 1 upon t, integration, xt, e to the power minus j, n omega t, and dt, for one time period, capital t naught, okay, fine. Same thing we'll do. So it is 1 upon the repetition, capital N need to repeat. So it is 1 upon capital N. And this integration, now it is a discrete. So I need to consider summation. Summation of this XPN. Right? And then it multiply with e to the power minus j, so again minus j k 2 pi upon n times small a. Is it right? Now this n, now here it's one interesting. So what is sample? So it is 0 to, it should be 0 to capital N. This is on time period, so for one time period we have to integrate. So I'll start 0 to n minus 1. Okay. But as it is a time limited signal, after n1, there is no change at all. So this this summation, just we can replace by n equal to 0 to n1 minus 1. And it is xpn e to the power minus j 2 pi upon n times small n. Now you see, as again, same context, same thing, same logic. If n is very large, then 2 pi upon n, its value is very small. Okay, k was there. It's very small. Then frequency, they're very close. So ck values are very close in nature. Okay, so you will get a continuous kind of thing. So this one, easily we can write. N equal to 0 to n1 minus 1. This is your xp of n. And this is k. K times of this one, this frequency, 2 pi upon n. That frequency I'll consider as e to the power minus j, a continuous frequency omega. And This is n. Same idea. And this one I'll consider as a function envelope, because this is 1 upon n, and you will take an envelope. If I consider this is an envelope, and this envelope is ET part, I write in this form. Earlier, we have used capital X of j omega. To differentiate this one from continuous domain, I write ET part j omega. Okay. Be careful. I am not writing X of j omega only, because it is a function of ET part of this one. And this idea will be more clear later, because this is coming from discrete sequence and gate transform. I think we have little bit discussed about the eigenfunction for a discrete system, right? So can you recall, please, what is the eigenfunction of a discrete system? Anybody? Any idea? What is the eigenfunction of a discrete system? Eigenfunction means whatever shape you will apply to the system, at the output end, you will get the same shape. Shape is same, but amplitude could be modified. All the samples could be amplified or attenuated, but in similar manner, with a constant scale. N to the power n. I think the xn is pieces of this form, to the power n. Then you will see that this xn convolution with hn will give you the similar thing. Some h of z times to the power n. Okay. And if z is et power, if I consider e only, that we can take from hello. So it is power n. So here you will see that you will come in that way. And z later will replace it by t power j omega. In continuous domain, you will see that we have considered e power st, the eigenfunction for continuous domain. Then we have seen that Fourier transform. Basically, you replace if it is h of s, e to power st, then Fourier transform is h of j omega. Okay, so if you replace here s equal to j omega, you will get h of j omega, and that is your Fourier transform. The same thing will happen here. First, we'll get h of z, then in the z, if you replace it for j omega, you will get Fourier transform. So this is actually Fourier transform of this xpn. And if this is an envelope, and you will take the samples here, say e to the power j omega here is k times 2 pi n times small n, that kind of thing. Okay? Or better that you can write in this way. This 1 upon n, this is the x of e to the power j omega n, where omega we are considered as k times 2 pi upon capital N. Okay? So in short, what I'm saying that this is your Fourier transform. So I write directly, we're taking too much time. Xn is a discrete sequence. Its Fourier transform will consider only this one, capital X of e to the power j omega. One thing. So x of j omega, right? So n will not be there, j omega. Okay. So and where this capital X of e to the power j omega is given by summation of xpn e to the power minus j omega n, and n you will consider for one time period n minus one, and its inverse Fourier transform. We can get xpn from this one, right? So it will be similar to the inverse Fourier transform continuous domain 1/2π. So I'll not repeat again. You can consider. So I have to get xpn, xpn in the Fourier series concept. It's the cn e to the power j n omega naught. Is 2π/n. Okay, don't get it is k, and it is n. So now, first of all, you should multiply capital N and divide by capital N here. Same strategy we can take as we have taken already taken for continuous time Fourier transform. You will get the similar result. It's 1/2π scaling factor, and then this is your x of. Fourier transform is capital X of e to the power j omega. That you need to multiply with e to the power plus j omega n, and omega is the continuous function, so you need to multiply with d omega. And here one important thing is that this integration will be for 1/2π. Okay, omega will vary for 2π. So anything. So you can start from 0 to 2π, or -π to 2π, anything. Okay. This second one is inverse Fourier transform of so these two will give you discrete time Fourier transform. First one is the Fourier transform, and second one is inverse Fourier transform. Is it clear? Some extension from continuous to discrete time domain. So as it discrete in time domain, we have take summation e to the power minus j omega n. After multiplying, and in frequency domain, the omega is continuous again, like earlier. So you need to take again integration. Okay, just take one example. And one important thing is that this x of e to the power j omega. Is it a periodic? Of 2π. Is it a periodic of 2π? Periodicity. Can you see? So if x of e to the power j omega is replaced by omega plus 2π, what you'll get? So omega is replaced by omega plus 2π, right? So it's summation. Xpn t power minus j omega plus 2π times n. Okay, n equals to 0 to n minus 1. It's okay. Now this one I can replace, I can expand it. Xpn, this is e to the power minus j omega n, this is e to the power minus j 2π n. Okay, n equals to 0 to n minus 1. Now what is this? Now, what is the value of the t-point j to pi? So can I write this one as xpn e to the power minus j omega n? This is e to the power j minus j to pi, and it is whole to the power n. Can you tell me what is the value of e to the power minus j to pi? Anyone?
One.
It's one. Exactly, it is one. Good. Because e to the power j theta is cos theta plus j sin theta. Okay. So e to the power minus j 2 pi n, 2 pi. So it is cos of minus 2 pi. Okay. So cos of 2 pi only. And it is minus sin j sin of 2 pi. And cos of 2 pi is 1. So e to the power minus j 2 pi is 1. So 1 to the power n. So this is equal to 1. So you see, it is xpn e to the power minus j omega n. N equal to minus, sorry, 0 to n minus 1. And you see, the first one and this one. So it is same. So this is again capital X of e to the power j omega. So if omega is shifted by 2 pi or integer multiple of 2 pi, it will remain same. So it is a periodic. So this is one difference from continuous time Fourier transform. In continuous time Fourier transform, there is no periodicity in the spectrum. But in discrete time, you are getting a periodicity in spectrum, periodicity of 2 pi. Okay. So just 1 minute, I'll take an example and then I will leave. Suppose I'll use one system. This is your xn, this is your hn, and this is your yn. And h of n, if it is like this, I'll take a simple, very simplest one, half and half. Okay, so if this system is like this, examine two sample, first one is half, second one is also half. Can you recall what is this system? We have discussed earlier. The yn, can you understand what is the yn in terms of xn? Anyone please?
1 by 2 x of 0 plus 1 by 2 x of 1.
Yes, that is for y of 1. Okay. And for y of n in general, and that will be your half of xn plus e delayed 1, xn minus 1. You are correct that you have said for y of 1 only. Okay. So this is current sample plus past sample by 2. It's the average of two consecutive samples. Can I say this one? It's the average value. And whenever you will take an average, it will give some sort of filtering, low pass filtering. Okay. Now we will try to understand this one, whether it is a low pass filter or not. Okay. So what is the Fourier transform of this h of n? That we are interested to understand. So this is your h of n. Now, what is the Fourier transform? So I want to get h, capital H, and e to the power j omega. Remember, for DTFT case, we'll always write e to the power j omega. So h of e to the power j omega, by definition of this one, is that h of n, so multiply e to the power minus j omega n, and it is for two sample only, so n equal to 0 and 1. That's all. So for this, what you will get? So h of 0 is half, and that time e to the power 0 is 1, plus h of 1 is half, and this n equal to 1, it is e to the power minus j omega. And that is multiply 1. Okay? So this one, this is half. This is 1 plus e to the power minus j omega. Now can I take common e to the power minus j omega by 2? So what will happen? The first one, so multiply by here, so you will divide it. So here you will get e to the power plus j omega by 2. If you multiply these two, you will get 1. Okay. And second one will become e to the power minus j omega by 2. Because e to the power minus j omega by 2, again e to the power minus j omega by 2, if you multiply these two, then you will get e to the power minus j omega. Okay. And it is divided by 2. So what is this? Second one. E to the power j omega by 2 plus e to the power minus j omega by 2 by 2 is the cos component. So this we can write e to the power minus j omega by 2. This is your cos of omega by 2. Okay. So what is the magnitude and phase? H of e to the power j omega. It's magnitude. So this first one, it is magnitude is 1 only. So magnitude of this cos of omega by 2, an angle. So this cos, suppose it can provide some minus 180 degree, all those things. But for when it is positive, then it is minus omega by 2. Okay. And when this function cos can be negative as well, no? When omega is more than, I think more than pi, right? When omega is more than pi, it will become negative. That negative minus 1 multiplied means pi phase shift will be there. So some pi phase shift could be there. So every time, whenever it's negative, so some k pi kind of thing. Okay, okay, don't consider this thing right now. So it is minus omega by 2, it's the angle. But more important thing is magnitude spectrum. And can I draw this magnitude spectrum? Magnitude of H of e to the power j omega. Okay. And you see, at omega equal to 0, what is the value? Cos of omega by 2, cos 0 is 1. So this is 1. And this is our pi. At pi, what is the value? Cos of pi by 2 is 0. And cos, so this is the waveform, cos waveform. Cos omega by 2 will become 0 here. And if it is more, then it's negative. But amplitude will become positive, no? So it will become positive this side. So left side, if I draw first, minus 5. You'll get like this. So you will see, you will get this kind of periodic nature. Yes. So minus pi to pi, if you know this shape, then you can repeat it. This is your omega. Okay. And you see, this is your 2 pi. It will repeat. So this is 0, this is 2 pi. Here, exactly, it will repeat. Again, 4 pi. It will repeat. Okay. And you see this function. That is the interesting thing. Okay. So at 0, its magnitude is high. As it is increasing, frequency is increasing, its magnitude reducing. At pi, it will become 0. So you see the low pass filter. Ideal low pass filter is look like this. But practical low pass filter, I told you that it will look like this. So is it, can I say that it is a low pass filter? Don't consider second half, OK? So this is your focus. 0 to pi. Fine. Next class will give you the mapping between this omega with actual frequency of the analog signal. So is it clear to all of you? So I am giving you one task. If h of n is half and minus half, then this is h of n. Okay. Then what is the corresponding h of e to the power j omega. Can you check? And is it a high pass filter? Okay, that you will try. Do you have any question from here? Any question, please? No question? So can you respond, please, that how much you have got the concept? Is it clear to all of you what we have discussed today? And I'm asking all of you, please raise your hand and ask some question if you have. Otherwise, you won't be able to understand all the concept. And this course is not a simple course. Okay, it's a fundamental course. It's a really tough course, full of mathematics. But once you will get the idea, you will become the master of this course, this subject. So anyone can please respond that whether you are getting this concept or not?
Yes, sir, we are getting.
Okay. Okay. So please let me know. Okay, you can email me as well. If you have any doubt, you email me. Okay. Next time, next class, we'll discuss those doubts. Okay. Thank you very much.